the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to do a roll call. Don Hubler is here. Amy Servio is not here. Hillary DeBay.
Present.
Sharon Ross.
Yep.
Jeff Pegg. Mary Hilton. Terry?
Here.
Thank you. We have four board members present. We had the meeting scheduled to run till 3 o'clock. Because of a number of scheduling items, we will end at 3 o'clock and no later. There's food over off the side. Please don't hesitate. This is lunchtime. And so during the meeting, if you want something, please do. That's all the candy in the bowls that we have. So once that's gone. I'd like to, hopefully during the meeting, I would hope that we, out of respect to the presenters, we listen to the presentations. If we have questions of clarification during the presentation, fine, that's an important thing. But if the board wants to deliberate or have a discussion, I would hope that we would do that after the presentation. Basically, so we get the full information before we have to go on with any other discussion. So the initial, we have a school district patron hearing. I see no patrons in the room. I didn't have any contact, so we'll move on past that to our first presentation for strategic plan.
Yes, thank you. I think at another time, I just want to put it on the record that I think we should have a discussion about board workshops in the future. I'd rather start the meeting like this because I don't know what the time will be at the end. But as to the point of board workshops or the content of board workshops versus committee of the whole, since we moved to the committee of the whole format, we have discussion-based items often pertinent to voting, but not always. We also have a presentation section of committee of the whole. So I think I just want to put it up for the future for a discussion, not today, but in the future about how we use workshops and perhaps making workshops about sort of larger, less specific issues that are more future focused, less targeted, less about preparing for voting, things like that, and try to delineate those subjects. I think we've tried to do that here today too, but let's just try to get a sense of what direction we want to do with workshops. I think the way we were using them was important before we had the committee of the whole structure, so let's figure out a different way to use them so they seem different. That's what I'm trying to create, a difference between a workshop, not just in style and how we sit and how we talk, but also in content, so it's not just whatever the pressing issue of the day is. I think we need to spend more time talking about the future. So first,
well, the point that I would ask, yeah, since you set the agenda with Amy, right, that you perhaps put that as an agenda,
right,
item.
For we could discuss at a meeting, right, exactly, have a little discussion at a meeting. Since now is the furthest point from the next workshop scheduled, basically since the next one, you know, we're the max distance out from the next workshop, I think it's enough time to have a little conversation about that.
Thank you.
Because if I recall, we talked about maybe do we need to have the board workshops or how would those be structured, and I think the conversation was at the time that while we were trying to improve and enhance board relationships, mm-hmm, and such, that we might be able to structure these in a way that there's more conversation,
correct,
and more discussion about the districts than let's say an agenda where, you know,
right, I like
so.
Yeah, I just wanted to put that out there so I didn't forget at the end. But I mean, I think another example could be perhaps we have a session where it's just myself and the board and we do board superintendent district planning, you know, mm-hmm, or the agenda item does not have an attachment and we just start talking,
yeah,
and Nikki's with us paying attention to how the conversation goes and we're doing some sort of, not a formalized strategic planning process, but a board superintendent planning process. Or 2 years from now, if you had your, Terry, 2 years from now, what would you like Mons Creuse to look like? Sharon, you know, for example,
mm-hmm,
those types of conversations that are more, we don't know where they're going to go, but we don't really have a chance to have those. And I think there's a way to structure
it. Or maybe we could structure it where we have like now and future. So in other words, maybe,
right,
there's some things like right now that at that meeting, we,
right,
could just say, let's talk about this, 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 and then for the future, And then let's try to do it like that, because sometimes it's hard to really put an agenda together that really meets the needs for the kind of a workshop that we might want.
So anyway,
It just as we explore that and discuss that, we need to remember board operating procedures.
Which state things, right?
Board operating procedures does state a purpose for each of the workshops.
Right.
So we just need to be mindful of what those are and think about whether or not we want to change them, if we want to set them aside, or how we want to do that as well. We just need to be mindful of those.
Good. You're right. Which is the first item.
And I think it's extremely a great opportunity to have a visionary meeting. Well, we're involved in the day-to-day operations and the scheduling of the next year and our recent goals. But I think for this, for our staff and the superintendent to see where the board sees the vision of the district, I think it is a important discussion that I hope that we have a chance to have. Thanks.
So the first item, I don't know who's pushing the button here. The first item is, are you going
to? Do you want us to stay up there?
Well,
it's up to you.
Where do you want?
We can try to use
this.
I want to keep, I'd like to keep the familiarity of this.
Well, we can't click.
Yeah.
From here.
So we will, Mike, you want to help with that? Just because Mike has, Mike,
okay.
I think, has the least to say, has the least to say for the first portion of the presentation.
Oh.
I think he was saying you need to.
Thank you, Mike. So this is our strategic plan update, which I believe we agreed in, I think, October to do this at the summer board workshop. It is not in a, this is designed for conversation for the cabinet members to discuss things. That you'll see things on here that are ongoing items. Some things started more than a year ago, some things started this past year, and then some things are things that we're going to be looking at for the future. They are aligned with the current goals. There was no change. We stuck to the model that was discussed of keeping the strategic plan the same, the sub-goals remain the same, and what our, how our work fits into those goals, basically. I wouldn't say that this is an all-inclusive list of all the work that we're doing. I would say this work fits into the strategic plan, and we would probably have further discussion on work that we're doing. If it doesn't fit in, does that mean we need to talk about strategic plan, or we need to talk about the work? So I think that that's a different conversation that we're going to have about this going forward. But you'll see things that are, if they're happening now, they will potentially be talked about. I did not hold it to things had to start by a certain date or have to be concluded by a certain date to be on this list of updates. Because I think even if things were started and are ongoing, we've made enhancements or they've evolved, and those are of interest to the board. So here we go. So I will. I have a few things sparsed in here that I'll bring up, but otherwise we're going to kind of ping pong between various members and focus on the work that they're doing in related to this. So first we have our curriculum goal, and there is a main goal. This is how the structure of this plan has worked, and then there are sub-goals, and you will see work under the main goal and then work under sub-goals as well. You have a copy, I think, if you'd like to follow along that way as well, and turn it over to the curriculum department.
Okay, so we're just kind of giving an overview. One thing that is not on here is we've spent the last couple days hiring again. So so 3 days, it's more days of hiring more teachers, so we're still working on that. That definitely doesn't fit in here. So we had some sub-goals of real-world experiences, things that kids are getting experience in beyond just sitting in the classroom. And some of these came to DCC, so if you were part of the DCC process, we talked about them there as well, the student externships in the work-based learning. Those were something that came to DCC. The CTE consortium is, we have expanded it a bit, and we have included Austin Academy, as well as we do have one of our students participating in the heavy equipment program, which is up in Richmond. And we talked about that a little bit because they had, it's a, not everybody has this program because you can't due to the type of equipment it is, and we weren't sure at the time if we were going to have a student, and now it looks like we are going to have a student.
Yeah, so on this one, so this is a program that existed a while ago, and we had a large, relatively large number of students involved. Mm-hmm. We feel like experiences are important for kids. This whether we offer them or not. There is no way currently for us to offer this program because the industry itself offers the program. AIS is a company and they give training. That's their training site as well as their commercial site as far as how to operate the commercial equipment that they lease and sell to a variety of construction companies. So we have this was pretty robust in the past. It went away. There's more student interest. These are high-paying jobs. They are high-demand jobs. And we have a student participating in this program again. It's well set up. It's an oiled machine. And they do get certified training in this class. And they get certified to, based on modules, operate this heavy equipment. So it's a very slow start. But Dean has been instrumental in, as we asked him to keep looking for expansion of CTE. So go ahead.
The CTE course expansion, which we've talked about several times at various board meetings with the HVAC course that's going to be expanding. The opening of the construction trades building, I know that we had kind of an official opening, but it's open. We've been working on it. You know, that's been a kind of a long process for that to be open. And yep, well, it's open, but
right.
Taking classes, kids
right.
will be participating in that building as well. And then the Macomb Marshall Plan development, I believe Eric has a little bit more information.
So that's one of my items I mentioned this at the board meeting, but I got involved in a subcommittee of, there's a lot of interest around, the governor released his was very interested in his Marshall Plan for talent development. And he has a department at MDE that has a little more clout right now than they had before, his economic development and talent department. Roger Curtis is his name. He's a very visionary. He's nice to work with. He's very visionary. He is not into the sort of compliance mode that, you know, we become frustrated with at times. And he was helpful to get the Marshall Plan finally done. They got it done. Very close to the budget being finished. It's not what everyone wanted, but it is money for not formally CT development, but for workforce training development that involves business. So in order to go for this money, you have to have formalized partnerships, likely with your ISD, and this is not sort of finding a company down the street and seeing if they'll hire one or two kids. This is larger scale partnership. Sort of like think of Manufacturing Day, which is coming up as well, but those becoming more semi-permanent jobs for kids, so they would have placement opportunities. Perhaps this is what this group is thinking about right now. They'd have placement opportunities in businesses, perhaps for work-based credit, and be doing things that are very targeted towards jobs that have to be high need. So it couldn't be in a job that is available, but it's not a real high demand, high need job. And you see these companies, that they've come to us in this group and said, we have all these openings and we're frustrated that we can't fill these jobs. So how can you help us? And now we're kind of we're dancing as to how that exactly will work. So, and it involves, it's a targeted piece with the Marshall Plan. So that is not just a Lance Creuse thing, but I would say that our foot's in the door on this a little bit more than others. We will have first dibs at this. I was asked to participate because we have a robust CT program already, so we have already been down the road of these types of things before. But the good thing for us is it gives us access, I think, to companies that don't touch our borders, that aren't just within Lance Creuse. And I have to say, one of the things that we've struggled with in CTE a little bit is that a lot of the businesses in our borders are smaller businesses, our smaller manufacturers. They're not the larger companies. Warren and Shelby and some other places have gigantic, very successful, huge companies, and they've got more need and more training capabilities. They've got their own training departments, things like that. So those access points will, I think, be helpful to our kids because, I mean, so the kid has to drive 10 miles, but they get to be involved in a fully fledged training program to learn how to do something, that there's advancement within the company. It's not, so you start here and you can move up to here within the same company, and it's, you know, at 16 and chainer, but this gives us access to that and kind of breaks down the border barriers of the district. So a little update on that, and that's sort of ongoing, and as we formalize the application, we're going to do this work whether we get the Marshall Plan money or not. I think that's the short version of that. So we're going to go for the grant, but
go ahead.
Yeah. I have a few.
Yeah.
In regards to the HVAC program, where are we in regards to that and the timeline to be able to start actually?
So it can't, it cannot start 2 weeks from now because the applicant, because of CT rules. It's approved. We can now buy equipment. We have, we're going to use the money from the grant we received, the grant money we received to buy the initial equipment. We think we have some more, we just found out another donation, possibly another company that's going to donate us some equipment. We can, and we're starting to try to find someone who will be a teacher for us. I don't exactly know the start date. We might be able to start mid-year on this program, but we can't start now because it was a CT timing rule. We applied in the window, then you have to have this period where you prove that you can actually run the program, which means have potential people that can instruct the program plus the equipment, and then you can actually apply a second time to start the program once they come out and check it. Since you're getting added cost money for it, they don't just give the added cost money on the word that you're doing it the way that they want to do it. So we haven't missed any deadlines. It's just that we can't start in 2 weeks, but we should be, as soon as we can start. I don't know exactly the date we're going to start. It's a good question. I think we can start mid-year. I think we can. Whether that becomes feasible or not is another question, but I believe we can start mid-year with this. We're now looking for instructors, which will be, it's very different than searching for a traditional teacher. as you know, we did, yeah, yes, and the challenge, and I don't want to monopolize on this slide, but the challenge in CTE is talent with your trade doesn't always mix with talent with teaching. Talent with teaching might mean you know nothing about the trade. So you're looking for the sweet spot between the two. We've got a lot of certification freedom now to take someone in without, if we have someone that's talented and shows some capacity to teach, we've done it in autos before, we've done a lot of different things where they are not
they'll
formally.
They'll still give you a waiver.
Oh yeah, they're not done with education at all. In fact, maybe they haven't even started on an education pathway, but we've seen success with doing alternative style certifications before. We'll be willing to do that if we.
When you
Sharon,
find,
yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No, it's okay.
I have one more.
I'm trying to switch back.
But my last one on the slide was on the construction trades building. When will we actually be using
it? No, we've been using it.
We've been using it.
Yes, that's correct.
Thank you.
Two things. Now that brings up something I was going to ask too. It'd be kind of cool. I think it'd be neat if we could go and see that building.
No, that's a good idea. Okay. Yeah, it was a soft opening.
I've seen a few pictures,
and we kept running it as a soft opening, but now
it's ready to roll.
Done.
Okay.
Maybe you could talk to Amy. We could meet a little before meeting.
Good idea.
Yeah. So the other question I was going to ask was: we're in the same boat with Hillary's question with the welding program also, where you have things you have to do, you get approval. Then you have to say, okay, we've got someone to do it, we've got a place to do it, we've got equipment.
Right.
And then you go back and reapply, right?
Correct.
Okay. So it's sort of like a pre-approval initially.
Right. We moved aggressively on the first one because we identified the grant money to be used for HVAC. And the generous donator of the grant wanted to know how it would be used. So that's how we started.
Right. Why not? And you know what? With building expansion going on all over the place.
Right.
That was
identified by Dean and John as the highest of the high needs. Oh,
absolutely.
So.
On a presentation to the Department of Education, they said very clearly partnerships with private industry is the conditioner for accessing the Marshall funds. And I like your point, and I think it's a very great point, providing access to our students to local businesses. I think that's a strong statement, so I think that can move
expanding that business list too, right?
Great, thank you.
Okay, next.
Next.
Yeah, so now the way the strategic plan is.
I'm sorry.
Okay. And I wanted just to clarify, Don, at the beginning, did you say that we should hold our questions about each thing?
No, but what I asked for clarification questions during the presentation, I think we have enough time to do that. But any deliberation between board members where we get a back and forth type of thing, I would hope we have separately.
Okay, so, but I can make a comment about this.
Sure, we can go let's go slide by slide, whatever, that's fine.
Real world experiences, and I think these are great, great opportunities for our kids. But I guess for real world experiences, I would be looking for a more
a more broad-based approach where it would affect all kids versus just some kids.
Just older
and
kids.
What too. I mean by that is, I really think that since we know what the goals and objectives are through our Michigan Department of Education, what the curriculum says and what the requirements are, I would hope that we could come to some of the innovation that's happening now where the kids at the high school, let's say, maybe there's something, a problem that's happening in our community, like the new invasive species of that have permeated the Great Lakes. It was just in the newspaper. Whatever it might be that our community faces as a real problem, it's been my experience that when kids are involved in solving real world problems, they're totally engaged. They're there and they want to be there. And then if we could figure out a way to say this is the freshman problem, or this is the class of 2018's problem, perhaps we will find solutions to problems that the adults in our community have not been able to sufficiently solve. So in other words, that truly to me is real world learning. So they would collect samples, they would try to find. And that's why I was so excited to hear about what you said about the zoo and that perhaps that marine zoo. But if we could fashion all of the good teaching and learning and strategies that this district has worked a lot on, the Marzano, and you know, there's so much good stuff, but if it could be framed in having kids solve real world problems. And then, oh, by the way, we will meet these objectives and this curriculum goals. But I think it would change it up so that kids are like, maybe at the end, the students would present their findings to people in the community or business leaders about, you know what, we have these new invasive species, we studied this, we did this, we collected this, this is our data, this is what we want to show you, and here's a couple of possible solutions. We'd like to present it to the Harrison Township Board. We'd like to, do you know what I mean? Where kids would totally get into that versus more, not that we do a lot of, you know, exercises and workbook kinds of things, but do you know what I mean? When I talk to a lot of young people, they would love to be engaged in some real meaningful work for the community or for the state of Michigan.
Great.
And I'm just saying that when we get to this, maybe that could be a goal.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Hi.
Good, thank you.
So now the structure breaks down into sub-goals, so there's a little more specificity, so.
I was gonna touch on that.
Laura, please.
And the first sub-goal is about providing experiences that problem solvers, critical thinkers, communicators, and collaborators. They have a lot of things going on that do emphasize those skills. We focused on here the things that we've been working on most recently. Classroom Instruction Networks is based on the work of Robert Barmano and company, and from that, we was at a workshop 2 weeks ago, and they asked you just for the overarching questions in this long-term planning, does your district have a consistent definition of what good instruction looks like? And we do, and this is it. The strategies and classroom instruction that works, the basis for the elements we evaluate in the teacher evaluation tool. So that training takes a variety of forms. Greg and I did what we thought was a nice basic training for all the new teachers last week. We have some plans to reinforce some of the skills that we have heard teachers would like the most help with, so that will go along with the teacher training part. And there are workshops offered through the ISD to take the full course, and we have asked our new teachers as part of the new teacher academy to choose that option.
For their new teacher professional development.
Yeah. The second one is Kagan. We continue to have people represent Lance Creuse at the 5-day Kagan training. One of the overarching, every lesson for every student every day is cooperative learning that should be present as part of the classroom environment. So Kagan structures are different groupings and tasks that support on the students working cooperatively. And we're working very hard to delineate, and the PD teachers know this, cooperative learning is not group work. Cooperative learning is intentionally designing lessons and structures to have kids interact and engage with their content. And that's why it is in that overarching umbrella of the classroom instruction number of strategies, because that student engagement with content and with each other is essential to high-level learning. So I don't have the numbers, but there was a ton there again last week when I was there.
Laura, so for clarification, that's a five-day training, and the whole goal is so that through these strategies that teachers can engage kids in cooperative learning. And is this for all teachers or certain grades or schools?
All teachers. Well, Lisa can explain more how she's offered to support financially through some grants. Some teachers going, principals have the option to use internal funds to send more teachers. And what I've heard a lot of buildings doing is a few teachers will go, like high school work group will represent it last week. So I know they're probably going to share this with others and taking pieces of that and having our teacher experts share out throughout the year different structures, examples, how to use them.
Okay, cool.
And that's one of the, like I said, one of the elements that are evaluated for all teachers is how students are organized to engage with their content. So teachers are on board because we're looking for that when we go into classrooms. So this is a great mechanism for achieving that.
Okay, thank you.
My observation, just that this is our teacher evaluation model. Okay, it is based on Marzano's work. That's why we call it the Marzano. You hear it referred to as Marzano. So the classroom instruction that works, a lot of the same strategies. It's not exact, but it is based on those strategies and those high leverage strategies that you look for to be in practice in the classroom.
We surveyed the teachers last year and might gather everyone in the spring, as many teachers as and discussed with them their needs.
So we brought in and we had teachers gather the group. But we had ended up in the springtime, we had representation from every level, every building, and every type of teacher within our district, and we had a feedback session. We shut the doors. I was the only administrator in the room. And we had an honest conversation on teacher evaluation, the model, our practices, so on and so forth. We used that feedback and also similar types of meetings with each level of building administrators. And then a group of us met over the summer and we brainstormed how can we address things that people cite as areas we could improve on. A work group then got together and we had all the building administrators into a 3-hour session, and we picked out the high leverage strategies that create the most learning, but also some that are the most difficult to identify and provide feedback on. And we had additional training provided by selected administrators within our district. And it was a great morning. I mean, to sit and learn with your colleagues and have your colleagues presenting their practices, and then we built in time for people to share additional practices. The entire time reflecting on what are the things we need to do better at, right? What were those comments from our teachers in the district? What were comments from building administrators in the district? So we left that day feeling really good. Because there's always things to improve on. Iterator reliability, right? We talked about that when we adopted this tool, right? The consistency of the practices, the ability to provide timely, well-constructed feedback to our teaching staff. So it was a great day, and I think it's going to be a great year with it.
And we feel well-positioned to start the year. Before the year starts, that everyone is as close to being on the same page as possible. There's no and then type thing. So we have to give our administrators the maximum amount of time to pre-meet with teachers, to begin their observations, to begin working with teachers on this. So there's not a October 1st start or October 15th start or something like that. This will be, which will help our administrators spend time with teachers that they want to spend more time with, and if they need to do that and identify those issues earlier in the school year. So I think that the good thing is it's a very even blanketing, and it's another attempt to be very honest with the teachers that we're looking for improvement in teaching and learning. It is not about the effect of you on you at the end when you receive your rating. It's about improving teaching and learning for the benefit of kids. And isn't everyone on the same page when that's how the conversation revolves? So
Sharon, you had?
I think that's fabulous. I'm glad to hear that we had, I'm assuming, some pretty good turnout and people felt validated and heard. Mm-hmm. We're gonna do this once a year.
Are you referring to with our administrators what I referenced last week?
The teachers in the room.
That formally, it was only one time last year. We are always meeting with teacher representatives.
No, I realize that. It felt like it was a really great forward progress to the place. Thank you. Where they feel they can come in and can say honestly anything they want to say, good or bad, and they know they're going to get some listening and perhaps some, obviously feedback, maybe changes. I mean, as you're talking about this, I'm thinking this is a fabulous thing. I'm excited that we did this, and it just feels like it might be something where we might want to just do it once a year just to sort of have a really, really good dialogue. I mean, I look at that right now as no different than some of the student committees that come in to meet with administration, some of the parent things that come in. We want to have our community involved. Our teachers are our community, our administrators are our community also. And I think it's a really great place, especially like you said before, when the school year starts. Come on in, let's all talk, let's see, let's do, let's whatever. Is this something we can handle right now? Is this going to take half the year next year? Just the idea of being able to come together on a regular basis. Once a year is fine, I think, unless everybody wants more. But it just felt really good to hear you say that.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay.
The next item on the list is regarding the adoption of the STEM scopes curriculum or the materials from that vendor, but it also coincides with the last item on the list. The reason why STEM scopes was adopted was because they so well supported the next generation science standards, which are K-12, the way that we're going to present that curriculum to the kindergartners and eighth graders is through STEM scopes. And the high school is looking at that as well to see if there's anything that they can adopt from STEM scopes into their daily instruction. But the crux of that whole thing is introducing the students to a phenomenon, something that's unexplainable, before they are instructed, and then they have to solve that problem. They have to figure out why does it happen that way? Why do the birds fly that way? Why does the water always end up in the same place within the ecosystem? So it does a good job of supporting the sub goal because it encourages them to critically think about the phenomena that is presented in front of them and problem solve in regards to why is that happening? How can we explain that? How can we better understand that? And quite often they're doing that in groups, and so they're having to communicate with each other, they're having to cooperate with each other. The same sort of thing ends up happening with the end of the EA, that's the name of the vendor, math, which is the acronym for the test. Because what it does is it measures the curriculum in regards to what do students learn, and more importantly, what are they ready to learn. And because that happens multiple times in the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade and the 9th grade as well now, during the same year, they're taking that test 3 times, those results are shared with the students, they're also shared with parents, and begin to critically think about, okay, what do I need to do in order to get to the next level within 7th grade math? What do I need to do in order to get to the next level within 6th grade English language arts? And they actually set goals for themselves, and they actually start thinking about what is it that I need to do to move to that next level. In those same lines, the PSAT, before I go there, it's worthy to mention the technology that's wrapped around the NLPA map. It's administered through a computer, but in and of itself, that's not all that great use of technology. Used for a lot of things. But where it really helps out is with the next two items I'm about to mention. It's an adaptive test. So within 3 to 4 questions, it finds the level that the student is currently at cognitively and adjusts itself to start asking questions at the appropriate level. That's something that could have never been done with paper and pencil in the past. And it's something that even teachers struggle with in a face-to-face situation when they've got 30, 35 kids in front of them. But the way technology is being used with that map test is that within the first few questions, they gauge where the student is, they start asking appropriate questions until they reach the frustration level. And so sometimes the test is longer for some students than others because it takes a while to find the frustration level. But it's important that the students know that. It's important that they understand they're not going to get every question right, because they're going to test until they get to a point where they kind of max out, so the teacher knows what they are ready to learn next. The PSAT does not use technology in that same way. It's more of a paper and pencil test, but it gives results. And when you take that test in the 9th or 10th grade, it will give you a very accurate representation of how you will score on the SAT if you took the SAT that same day. So the PSAT is not as long, it's not as rigorous, but because it's highly correlated with the SAT, it comes from the same vendor, we have a very good means by which to predict what's going to happen and then begin to develop strategies with the students on how they can better prepare. What we're seeing is that students, on average, will gain about 150 points between PSAT and SAT. And so we can start to strategize, problem solve, operate in regards to, okay, how are we going to make sure they get there? And if they take it a second time, we sort of know whether or not they're on track. Jumping back to NWEA Math, one of the great uses of technology there, the second point I wanted to point out, is those results are almost instantaneous. And so within a day, the teachers can begin previewing. Within a week, they get very detailed reports about all of the students in their class. Unlike the SAT, which ends up going out to be scored, sent back, it takes a little bit longer. So both of those batteries of tests and the STEM scopes and next generation science standards are focusing on what do our students know, how can they move forward, and the students are facing problems that they are expected to solve, whether it's figuring out the cognitive level or figuring out how to get to the next step, how to get to the next step.
Sharon, you had a question?
Just a quick question. When the program starts going, you know, the 3 or 4 questions to find out, you know, what direction to go. Do we ever have, or have we ever had a place where, let's say, those first couple of questions would indicate that maybe the student isn't quite here, and so it sends the questions here. But what if the next question after that is something that that student really excels in, and they would shine? Does this predictive system able to realize that?
Yes.
Okay, he's finding this a little bit too easy.
Up and down.
Yes, it doesn't just do it one time. It doesn't just do it once.
It's adaptive. I knew it was adaptive, but I thought once you get moved into an adaption, that's where
you're going to stay. No, right, you can shift. You can shift back. Right.
Okay, good, thanks.
Hillary?
Can you, Dr. Dixon, talk me through or kind of walk me through the NWEA, you said, 3 times a year testing along, because that's in addition to, like, PSAT and SAT testing, correct?
Yes.
So that,
but not at all the grade level.
Not at all.
Right. To me, it sounds like a lot of testing. So
the ninth graders are the ones right now that have done all of those. And this coming year, the state of Michigan is pushing the PSAT down to 8th graders. So they're going to have 4 sessions. So what's going to end up happening is that if you're in the 8th or 9th grade, you will NWEA map test 3 times, and you will take the PSAT 1 time, but it still equates to less than 1% of the overall instructional time throughout the year. In the grand scheme of things, it might feel intrusive sometimes to students who feel like, oh, I'm taking a lot of tests, but it's still less than 1% of their time in the classroom. The nice thing about the NWEA map is it's usually done within the content teacher, and it usually is done within that class period, so you're not sitting there for 3 hours at a time. The PSAT is a little bit different. We like to administer that in longer blocks and have it in a more controlled situation from the standpoint of the College Board is very rigorous in regards to how close they sit next to each other. The instructions are read exactly alike for everybody because it's being a million students or more, they want to make sure everybody has the exact same testing required.
So it's not like what we were accustomed to when we were younger. You sit at your desk. It's a week-long process that takes over
correct.
The school.
No.
It's no longer like that. It's something correct. Completely different.
Much friendlier.
Yes. Okay. Thank
and
you.
The state requires that we benchmark our students in grades 3 through 8. So that in our grade meets that requirement. The PSAT at 8 will replace the MSTEP. So when I bring all of this, the PSAT at 9 MSTEP will replace the MSTEP at 8th grade for now.
Thank you.
So next is the adoption of the elementary May sobriety units. Mayor from out the writing committee this morning. She planned the opening day PD to get teachers going. We talked about this at the past board meetings, but just a refresher, the Michigan Association of Intermediate School Administrators. So teachers across the state were involved in writing machines. Around for a long time through the process and career evaluation tool this year, we did choose to adopt them for K-5. How it supports problem solving, critical thinking, it's all about growing the writer. It's all about writer's workshop and us providing them with some mini lesson skills and then students using those skills, connecting them to their own ideas, their seeds, we call them, and growing them as writers in a variety of different writing genres. So we're very excited to see that. I've been fortunate enough to see it in action. Kids all over the room, working at different levels of their pieces, and it's extraordinary what they're able to do. So I look forward to seeing some growth in their writing. Atlas?
Sure. Atlas is not new. It's something that's been around for a while and is being utilized by many other districts. I believe it's 3 to 5 years ago we started putting our curriculum into Atlas because it's a way that not only can all of our teachers share the very best lesson plans and take a look at what are the standards that should be covered within their classroom, they can also see what is it that the students were exposed to before they came to my classroom? And then see what it is that the students need to be ready for when they leave my classroom. So it's internet-based, and there is a parent component that we've just begun to open up. They don't see everything that the teachers do. They don't see the assessments. They don't see the lesson plans. But they can see what the learning expectations are for their students. And some of the very best things that we put in there are those lesson plans that and the problem solving and collaboration between the students. So it's one of the ways that technology is being used by Lance Creuse and some of our neighbors from Cone County are getting on board as well in order to share. And what we know about sharing, whether it's students or whether it's teachers, is that's how they learn more, that's how they improve, that's how they reflect best, and it's a big boon to the teachers because now you don't have to fight with a three-ring binder that's in someone's classroom anymore. And a lot of the credit goes to the academic coaches for driving this particular initiative to make sure that those resources are there for all of our students in this year with the opening of the parents as well.
So then a parent could walk into our curriculum office and say, my child is in this class, what are the standards, or what is the curriculum in that class? They would be able to use the Atlas to be able to say, okay, here's the information that's being taught in that class.
Correct. Yeah. Before the year's over, I anticipate that they'll do that on their own smartphone. Okay.
I'm sorry, you said it, before the year's over?
Look at what the learning expectations are for their students' class on the internet themselves.
Our goals with this include, obviously, not all at once. We've got a plan, you know, that would be which subjects, which grades, when, the MESA units for elementary, those are in there because those are easy for us to move from one place to another because they're set up in a similar manner. KA science is not yet in there. Now that we have online access, the hope is that they have a similar tool. It's a lot of manual work.
We've got our target goals that were already established.
And we already touched on next generation science. Is that?
Yes. Remember when we did really awesome big whiteboard presentation so the board could see the technology that was being used in the classroom?
Oh, the smart board.
Upstairs, we did
smart
upstairs.
Board. Upstairs, yeah. Can we see how some of this stuff works too?
Absolutely.
Yeah, when we open the parent portal for sure.
No, I'd be happy to show you.
Because it sounds amazing, and I'd love to see it, but we're just sitting here taking the information going.
Yeah, we'll go through the structure.
It is not as fun to describe. I didn't think so.
That's what I just wanted to look at. I need to show you. I'll be on that Facebook video.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a good idea.
Cool. Thank you. It would just also feel to me personally that I really, really understand far more what it is we're using, and for parents or the students, but.
Well, we appreciate referrals too, in the sense that when people come to you and ask you, how do you know about something like that? If you have some personal knowledge of,
right.
Here's how you go look at it.
Yeah.
That's good.
By the way, I think it's fabulous.
Right, exactly.
Thank you.
Our next goal, Nancy's going to help with as well. This is our student support in our diverse learners. Something that we were able to offer this summer, and we actually invited one of our neighbors to join us, was SIOP, the Sheltered Instruction Observation Protocol. This is a very intense training for teachers to support their ELL students. And it's good instruction to support any struggling learners, but it was originally designed for ELL learners. And it is a training that we're not allowed to, I can't train a trainer to then train people in. It has to be by a certified trainer. And we were able to use some grant money. We had a certified trainer. It was the same day as new teacher orientation. They were upstairs. Some of our staff, as well as Warren Wood's staff, were trained in that. The LLI, the Level Literacy Intervention, we brought forth at one of our committee of the wholes because we were purchasing them with grant money. Those are supports for intervention for literacy. The Advantage Math Recovery is a very neat program that we are partnering with the MISD. They selected one school 2 years ago, then we expanded last year to another school. This is an intensive training for elementary teachers to support math interventions in a way that it's much easier in reading to say you don't know your letters, you don't know your sounds. In math, it's not that simple once you get past, as the business office knows, once you get past teaching them the numbers and the counting, it's very difficult sometimes when students struggle in math to figure out what the root of the problem is. And this particular research-based program has gone a long way in determining what things students need, and its whole goal is correcting those things that are a structure or a basis to be able to move on. So that once you master it, just like counting, once you master it, we don't practice it anymore. And so that is something that we've participated in that just is pretty recent. We put eye observation training for administrators on there because that is supportive of the students in the way that we talked about how the teachers are teaching the strategies, the administrators are observing the strategies, but good strategies support our learners. And then the next few are Nancy's specialty.
Our students who are in our school system who receive special education services, the majority of them follow the state core curriculum. However, we do have additional differentiated instructional methodologies and strategies that we implement in our resource classrooms K through 12. There are other interventions that are not listed in here. These are just interventions that we either introduced last year that we are expanding. So reading mastery, we've expanded that through all elementary K-2 resource rooms. It's delivery of evidence-based reading instruction that goes above and beyond the core instruction that the teacher's already doing. Corrective reading, that goes from grades 3 all the way through 12. It has different levels. And once again, it's in addition to the core instruction that the students are receiving in reading. And it depends where they test, and it depends, of course, on their IEP as well. The unique learning systems was introduced last year, and it's being used right now, implemented in our elementary self-contained cognitively impaired classrooms and middle school cognitively impaired classrooms. And their curriculum is an extension of the general ed curriculum. It is designed specifically to meet the needs of the students in that classroom, in addition to what the teacher's doing, and it has proven to be very, very successful.
Okay, our next sub-goal are the creating...
In regards to the resource rooms for our students, obviously I have experience in seeing how resource rooms work pretty extensively. There are also TI rooms, correct?
TC rooms.
TC rooms. Thank you, Alan. What is the other letter I'm looking for? TC rooms. I think TC rooms are very important in our buildings as well. I think that we need to make sure that we're supporting those and that those for our struggling learners are being utilize as much as they can also, because I know that those, I don't know if you can speak to a little bit, I don't know if everybody knows what TC rooms
we have teacher consultant rooms in our high schools, and I believe each high school is either staffed at 5 or 6 hours a day. Those are very specific to students receiving teacher consultant services. However, we're able to expand opportunities to students with IEPs who may need a test read or may need some additional help. Let's say that their IEP doesn't call for resource room science, however, they may have a reading disability, so they may need a test read or some support going through the test with their accommodations. We have multiple numbers of students that go down there every day, every hour, and they are very important resource in our buildings. They are very busy all day long in both high schools, and the teachers will speak to that. Sometimes there are tests that are taken down there. Sometimes students are assessed down there, but it's a wonderful support for all of our students who need to access that resource.
How likely are we to get them in middle schools and elementary schools?
We don't have teacher consultants per se in our middle schools. Most of our classrooms are resource rooms. We have many students who need direct services. There are different designs in different districts. However, there are very few kids that would need just a half hour of service or minimal teacher-student contact time.
Just seeing the impact that it's had on so many students at the high school level, just being able to mirror what you said, to utilize it for if they do need that extended test-taking time, or they do need directions rather than they need a quieter environment to take their test to be able to perform better, so to speak. If that room would be available, I could see students at a middle school level benefiting from that.
I can't speak. I can speak for three out of the four middle schools right now. We do have some support at the middle schools where the students are able. We do have it in their IEPs, and we do have it staffed where someone's able to help them read the test or support them with that. So we have made that available, even though we haven't. That would be an additional staff member that we would have to add to each middle school that would just man a TC room 6 hours a day, if we were to look at that concept, in addition to the teachers we already have. That's just, that would be how we would staff that. But we do have rooms where, because we do have it written in certain IEPs where the students may go and access those points. And we've made that available. We find creative ways to make sure that that happens. But thank you, that's an excellent point. And it's been very supportive.
Yeah. How does that mesh with the state's really kind of their directive about making sure that students at the secondary level are taught by highly qualified staff, which is why a lot of resource rooms kind of went by the wayside, because we're supposed to have teachers really provide that support in the classroom. So as much as I understand where there might be, can you help?
Sure. The teacher consultant room is not an hour. A teacher may staff it that may be highly qualified in math. That student's not spending the entire hour down necessarily in that resource room. In that teacher consultant. It may be that the student receives instruction by the highly qualified teacher
in the classroom.
They meet in the classroom under the highly qualified teacher or teachers if it's a co-taught classroom. And then those students or that student would then go down to the teacher consultant room for that additional support. Or if they had additional help.
Okay.
It is not, it's
where the old days it's where a teacher would be there.
Exactly.
Okay.
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Good question.
Okay, our next sub-goal is creating the opportunity for students to analyze, synthesize, and evaluate information related to local and global issues. This will kind of be everybody sharing a little bit of everything. I'll let Kelly share her the first one, because that's one that she's worked on pretty extensively.
The career fair is something that we have done now for 3 years. Annually in the late winter, February, we have an event where we invite local business leaders, alumni to come in and talk to our middle school and high school students about their careers and answer questions that the kids might have to help them kind of see what direction they may want to go in the future. It's been a very successful event, lately, and the Panko Center is instrumental in moving this piece forward and gave us close. Work specifically with the career portion of this, and she has really moved this up to the next level.
The Leader in Me projects, you've had a couple presentations from Leader in Me, but those are continuing to expand the deeper the schools get into the program. Each year has a different level of involvement, per se, about learning the program and then moving into actual projects, service learning projects, those types of things. And they vary based on the age of the student and the interest of the student. So this is a little bit about what Terry was talking about at the elementary level. The students get to choose their projects as a class. So they do a variety of different brainstorming sessions. Everybody kind of puts their thing in, and then they decide, well, fourth grade, we're going to support the Humane Society, let's say, and we're going to do this project, and it spans over several weeks, sometimes several months, of planning for it, how they're going to get all the materials, how they're going to create whatever their distribution. The kids do all of that, and then it culminates in that final project, and it changes year to year. The teacher, of course, gives some sort of influence, because sometimes, I mean, we have to be able to stay within our, can't fly places, you know, we have to kind of, but they let them brainstorm those types of things. Anti-bullying and kindness programs, those are always expanding into a variety of different ways. We've brought stuff forward before, talking about the positive behavior intervention systems, but the anti-bullying has also kind of turned into kindness programs, not just about educating students on, you know, what it means to, you know, bully, those types of things, but about being kind and how those things fit together. And that's really been something that's kind of spurred on in the last couple years. We've always talked about anti-bullying, but not as much as this a formal focus on what it means to be kind. I mean, definitely we teach kids, you know, not to bully, but the kindness part. And then I'm going to let Greg step in for some of the high school things that we have on
there. I just want to jump in real quick that, you know, elementary is really doing a great job. I'm not saying secondary doesn't speak to elementary. Those kind of programs are embedded in their everyday culture. They're really excited. A few of them went to a sort of practices 2 weeks ago, last week. And the speaker is phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. There were teachers there from different buildings. Administrators and so they're working right now because it's actually more reasonably cost than you would expect. So the elementaries are looking at bringing him in for one of our PD days so that all of them, all of the teachers and administrators at that level can experience that presentation.
It's you kind of just led into something that I just jotted down. About the secondary level, in the anti-bullying and the kindness programs at the secondary level, when I attend a dialogue day and we listen to a lot of the students talk about anti-bullying and bullying, they said, do not send me to another assembly. They said, the assemblies really do nothing for us. And that was a big thing that I took away from dialogue day. So I'm wondering, as we see it here, what are we doing at the secondary level in regards to the anti-bullying and the kindness programs?
It looks like from year to year at the secondary level, primarily because the student leaders are involved each year in regards. down. So rather than going and putting something up, the positive affirmation wall is taking it down and passing it on to somebody else. 1 year it was be a buddy, not a bully, and then that ebbs and flows and evolves over time as well in regards to, well, what does it look like? And they do a pretty good job through the round tables, as Steve mentioned the other day, and through the student leadership groups of the club officers, the president, the vice president, the student council, the leadership groups, various student
advisory
group, in regards to gathering what is going to be meaningful and what have you seen. And then one of the things that is really nice in the last couple of years, the student councils have been able to go to state conferences and take ideas from other schools when they've seen formal presentations from other schools in regards to what worked. And so we're starting to see more and more of that in regards to initiated initiatives in regards to sit and get assemblies. And one of the things that even Kim Roski mentioned the other night was they want to move away from those school-wide assemblies or grade-level assemblies because they're realizing the message is lost. When you're right. speaking to 400 students at a time, it's so much more effective to go into classrooms. And so we're starting to see more and more of that.
Thank you.
This is a follow-up to that. I know some schools that I've been, whether it's bullying or whether it's positive behavior support, are finding a lot of success with small groups of kids, that even at the classroom level, where, like on the bullying, they like act out skits about this is what bullying is and this is what it isn't, or this is the kind of when you're going to the lunchroom, they actually role play how kids might be going to the lunchroom, and what do you see with that? Is there anything wrong with that or the behavior? It's engaging them in that kind of behavior that really seems to cement because they're actively engaged in trying to figure out the differences and the similarities. So that might be something we could do in lieu of, what did you call it? Assemblies.
I'll throw one other thing out there very quickly.
Yeah.
But it was in the news just last week. I think that we are having an impact as schools because recently a incoming class of freshmen walked out of the presentation because they realized that what was happening by the stand-up comedian that was hired to entertain them was harassing in nature and bullying. So it's not a result of what happened to those students when they got out of college, because they hadn't even started their college coursework yet. They're coming into college knowing what harassment looks like, what bullying looks like, and emboldened and encouraged to stand up for victims and not let it persist. So it's not a direct correlation, it's just something that's been newsflash, because I'm seeing more and more people are understanding the difference between being mean, bullying, harassing, and people are standing up more and more for kindness rather than meanness.
I'll add too, I think the work in restorative practices that's taken off last year, it's not inherently preventative in nature because
right.
it's more about reacting to some situation that occurred, but if done successfully, it creates preventative behaviors in the future. So if you have a successful restorative circle or a restorative practice session with kids, I don't have good data to announce right now, but I have been impressed with administrators that I thought would be more reluctant to that style of resolving conflicts and issues who have taken it up more because it actually works. So in other words, their reluctance was not so much they didn't try to start doing it, and they have leaned on John and Kelly, who were our main trainers this past year, John Haas being the most embedded with this personally himself, and he is kind of giving advice to people, strategizing with administrators. He's the go-to on that. But for example, if there is a bullying scenario in a restorative practice circle is appropriate, you do that. What our administrators will tell you is the effects of that are those two kids' chances of having problems are greatly diminished versus a more traditional style consequence in that type of scenario. So that, I think that fits in very well too.
Well, and also too, you know, just like last evening, we had a big discussion because of what we saw on TV, which was the UCN students ripping down a statue that had stood on that campus for over 100 years and totally destroying it because some students found it was divisive.
Mm-hmm.
They felt that it was divisive. Well,
you know, the conversation with my sons were, well, that may be, but there's a process that you would go, you know, hey, we find this, and, you know, go through a process rather than just destroying something that other people might not find, you know what I mean? So it's that kind of thing. Our society is moving along so rapidly that having those conversations kids really want to have, and yet are we providing those opportunities? Because maybe every family doesn't sit around and talk about this.
Right. It's genuine conversation versus technology soundbite information, right? It's like, and you have to be comfortable in those, not knowing what will happen next, but just having a safe environment so it can be safe, but you don't try to manage how the students talk. You know, you let them have conversation, only intervene if it becomes inappropriate, and it's like kids will impress you in those situations more than you expect, you know
because
what I mean?
My son said, out of the mountains of babes, he said, Mom, what happens to kids that see this on their phones? And then they think that that's okay.
Right.
They go off to college and they think that's okay because they saw it on...
Right.
That's what you're saying.
So,
anyways. Great.
I have
the...
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Okay. All I wanted to say was that I personally find, I've been sitting on the Student Advisory Committee for a few years, I love that they're getting... the interaction and the voices heard. When that whole thing started with people just, you know, organically decided to start putting lovely, positive messages with sticky notes on lockers, you know, in all over, you know, different schools around the country. What a difference that made, especially for those kids who are maybe too shy to say anything, or those kids who get bullied all the time for whatever the reason is. We consider as parents and say, well, I've taught my kid. Well, evidently, two things. You either taught them they're not listening, or you didn't teach them they're doing it anyway, because it's still very, very large and very, very prevalent and very destructive. So I was at high school one time, and they had that wonderful wall where you just went up and wrote up a beautiful, positive whatever thing or something that was really wonderful that day. I like the, you know, the one where you could take away a good thing. That's letting them be engaged. That's letting them be heard. That's letting them solve, like, this restorative group stuff. You're right, if you put two people together who've been fighting for whatever reason, physically, verbally, you know, over social media, whatever, and you actually make them look at each other, that's the biggest key. Let me look you in the eye. And then let's have that conversation. Let's resolve this thing. And by the way, oh, that was all based on a misunderstanding or a lie? So sorry, let's not do that again. Mm-hmm. This is fabulous stuff we're doing.
I'm sorry, as Chair, we're coming on almost halfway through our meeting.
Okay.
So we should, there's a lot of good information. I think there's critical bias. I think we should move forward.
I think the next few bullets.
Very important for the curriculum department, so yes.
Yes.
Sorry, Rochelle. Rochelle's slides updates are do my best to find the money to do all the stuff for curriculum.
Oh, thank you.
All
right.
We're done. Thank you. And everyone
has a recommendation for
that's,
it. We'll
that's how we operate. That's
the
right.
Just take a donation. I think I have the next three bullets. I believe this past year, Lisa Shea and Leslie Wheelock, two teacher consultants, special education teacher consultants, who work at PinkOut with all of our students receiving special education services when they go over there for classes, and they really head up our high school transition, which is a big piece of what we do in the special education department. I just wanted to highlight grades 9 and 10, the pre-employment transition services. We call it PREETS, if you ever hear that acronym out there. A year ago, we really took off in our district. It was introduced the year before last, but the reason it's on here for the last school year is because last school year, we fully implemented PREETS for all 9th and 10th graders. A lot of the areas that it covers is job exploration, work-based learning experiences, counseling on post-secondary education programs, workplace readiness, self-advocacy, and peer mentoring programs. And what this does is it's a grant through Michigan Rehabilitation Services. It's a nationwide grant that was added and provided for all local educational agencies because we were starting transition services too late, frankly. For our students, we were not able to really start introducing them to some things, even though their IEP says we look at this in eighth grade. we really weren't able to do much until 11th or 12th grade. Well, everyone here, I'm sure, agrees, and you know, everyone beyond Lance Creuse agreed that it was too late. We are doing a lot of these activities in our resource rooms. However, we have building-wide committees where we are making sure that our teachers have the tools in the resource rooms to embed some activities. We have the teacher consultants, school social workers, other special education teachers, where we are all working together with Michigan Rehabilitation Services and the PREETS grant to make sure that we continue to bring in as many transition opportunities for our 9th and 10th graders, so that when we get to the wonderful things that we're doing with grades 11 and 12, we're continuing to build upon those initial introductions. We spend a lot of time assessing students with transition tool assessments, which brings me to TAG, which is a transition goal generator. There are different assessments. We have a multitude of assessments for special education students 9 through 12. However, not all assessments are geared towards certain students. For example, our students who have an alternative curriculum, who may be our certification of completion students, we do a different set of assessments with them and glean information that is most important for their career track. Students who may be college bound, we have a different set of assessments that we glean information from. TAG is something that the ISD has supported the cost for us and other local districts who were willing to take part. We were willing to take part in this. There is some overlap, however, there are pieces of TAG that are not covered in some of those other assessments. And the state has been real clear, and the feds have been real clear, about making sure we have multiple assessments for transition first, transition planning for our students. Not just one, not just two. So I credit our special education teacher consultants, our special education teachers at the high school, our school social workers at the high school. We have a strong representation at the Macomb Intermediate School District training and meetings, and continually try to bring the wealth of that planning back to our students so we can individualize what they need to maximize their potential post-secondary. So we've always had a very strong transition piece in the department, but I'm really excited because we now have an opportunity to expand it, and it's just wonderful watching the students respond. More connection with the parents early on as opposed to 11th grade. Even though we talk to parents early on, when you get them involved, actively involved in meetings, trainings, other connections, it really helps them collaborate with us in guiding their student, their child. So I just wanted to mention, we do many things, but these are some things in the last year.
And just to speak to that, I personally have experience with this, and I've seen this outside of my own household, and how it affects so many students, and it's outstanding work. And the work of both Mrs. Shea and Mrs. Wheelock is outstanding, and it's been incredible how they've really grown. It's changed so much from when my son was a ninth grader. We didn't have the ninth and tenth grade. So I was actually that mom who said in tenth grade, well, no, we're going to start something, so you might as well give me something to start because we're going to do this. But the programs are outstanding. My son is looking at employment, looking at full employment coming out of high school, and it's all directly attributed to
these programs. That's great. That's great.
So
that's great.
They are outstanding, and we are very fortunate to have them.
Well, thank you.